Let's do it.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Manila Major. We're here with one of four opening matches, Digital Chaos and Wings Gaming. Today is the first day of the group stage. I'm Zayori, joined by Coddle Guy. You're watching the Dota Major stream number three, and this is one hell of a best of three we've got set up here. DC Wings Gaming, the first time in Dota history. Dakota, how you feeling, my man?
I'm feeling wonderful, Andrew. Thank you so much for having me. Excited to be here. Excited to dive into some of the Manila action. Obviously, the two of us are going to be doing it from our comfort of our own home or apartment. So we're going to be bringing you some of the best casting coverage you could ask for. No stiffy suits for us. I am sporting full-blown sweatpants for this one, Andrew.
Yeah, me too. It's nice and warm here on the East Coast. I'm rocking the basketball shorts and unmarked t-shirt tonight. So I'm going bipartisan, you know. This is probably one of the more even opening games as well, Dakota. The bets are like 55-45, slightly in favor of Wings Gaming. But this is not a matchup that I would want to put my rares on, man. This one I feel like could really go either way. Both these teams are really hot right now.
Yeah, I mean, I could see it going either way for it being split 50-50. And I also feel like for a lot of the community and a lot from what we hear, a lot of people do continue to kind of underrate how good Wings actually is. We can't forget this team has won a LAN. They've gone into a grand final against Liquid, which many consider the best in the world right now. Mm-hmm. And they just continue to sleep on this team when really they could be the next, you know, CDEC from TI5 in this major run. So we'll see, though. Digital Chaos also on a really big high here. They've crushed Complexity, what feels like four or five times straight, who, as we know, Complexity have already been making huge waves for themselves in a lot of these huge international lands. But as you mentioned, both these teams, you know, they could use a bit more experience, maybe having some international competition. I'm more eager to see how Digital Chaos is going to be comparing up to Wings.
Yeah, absolutely. And Wings is a tough opponent for DC. I mean, they've got kind of a tough group, regardless. Secret as well as Na'Vi also going to be here alongside Wings and DC. But Wings is a team that definitely switches it up a little bit. They're one of few teams that plays Visage on this patch. Drow Ranger, something they pull out more often than a lot of other teams. Even Weaver, it seems like they really like these high mobility here. Heroes. Even this second pick, Dazzle, at least the regions I've been covering in North America and C have not been playing much Dazzle. So to see Wings prioritize him this much, second pick, definitely a change of pace.
Another exciting thing I'm looking forward to, by the way, with both these teams is they're not afraid to get creative and work with what's kind of that new up and coming trendy pick or that new up and coming meta that people are discovering. We'll probably see a Timbersaw, for example, pop up in this series. Both these teams have been sporting him quite a bit, and in a meta where it's good to recognize stuff like, there seems to be a lot of tremendous strength core potential. You're seeing a lot of, you know, Tide Hunters and Armlet Holders like Lifestealer and Alchemist. And suddenly someone like a Timbersaw, who normally is just kind of waiting in the shadows, suddenly becomes a bit more appealing. One team shows how awesome he is. The next team picks it up. The next team. Well, Wings and DC are usually at the front of that line to try out those new things. So we could see a Timber, we could see an Elder Titan, we could see some funky stuff, but one thing I don't like to see at the start of my draft is letting something like a Beastmaster get through, and especially in the hands of Wings. These guys play a sick Beastmaster here. I hope DC don't regret handing it over. It is just game number one of a best of three here, but I would be nervous about that.
Yeah, absolutely. The Beastmaster is such a great opener because he's so flexible, kind of similar to that Doom. You can put him in the position 3 and off lane. You can always just put him in the jungle. The Iron Talon works wonders for the Beastmaster, as we've seen oh so many times. DC, though, continuing with pretty smart bans, Lycan as well as the Drow Ranger that we briefly mentioned earlier, taken out. You know, I was talking about Wings pocket picks, but you can't forget about DC. They're one of the few teams that still runs Lina in kind of a core role, and of course, the Wii Meepo. That's one that you always need to be cautious of. Pocket pick that they are not afraid to pull out. I think they played it in one of their third most recent game 6 days ago against Complexity. So it's still ripe in their arsenal.
And I think it's more likely to see them pull something like a Meepo out against a team like Wings or a Chinese team who have very, very little experience going against the Meepo in the first place. It was Meepo that helped guide the way for both OG and Secret, which had Weeha at the time, through the Frankfurt Major and get them into, like, you know, that final four position. And, you know, it just seeing those teams struggle against going, you know, not recognizing the potential of how much this Meepo can farm up and just really accelerate, and not having the experience of shutting down a Meepo. Wings mm-hmm. Gaming could also maybe fall prey to that, but who knows? It's Wings. Yeah. Maybe some of these kids are very rambunctious and play Meepo themselves. We'll have to see, nonetheless.
Yeah, time will tell. Lifestealer Lion, though, a pretty safe opener for Digital Chaos. We've seen a lot of Lifestealer play on this patch. I think he's definitely been a tried and true classic. The armlet is so good on him, and a variety of builds. You can go for the Midas, either rush it if you got to get a lot of space in the lane. We've seen some Lifestealers go for a couple core items first, even like a phase drum, and then pick up that Midas after you've picked up a couple of kills and gotten involved in those early pushes. But one thing that is definitely true for the Lifestealers, you need somebody to be the delivery vehicle for that Infest Bomb. And Lion is one of those heroes. Once he gets a Blink Dagger, these two can be the roaming duo that can move around the enemy jungle, look for pickoffs, and the Blink Hex into Finger, Infest, right click. It's pretty devastating. But we'll see where DC go from here. They're going to pick up a Winter Wyvern with their third, so that'll be their second support.
It is nice once the Lion gets that Blink Dagger to be that vehicle, but you obviously might want something to be able to take advantage of once, level sixes are first coming out and the fireworks really begin to pop a bit. So, you see some teams still reach for something like the mid lane Puck or Queen of Pain, and I can see DC going for something like that. But for now, as you mentioned, stepping off for the Wyvern, we don't see this very often at all. Helps, obviously, some extra sustain power. I don't know what this kind of says for the draft right now, otherwise, other beside that, Digital Chaos just want to have a good sustained support to possibly hang around their mid lane in case there's possibly some early aggression against Wings. It helps nicely against the Beastmaster and any sort of heavy push strat because his Splinter Shot is very good at spamming out the waves from a good distance away, but the other nice thing, I guess, is that his ultimate, the Wyvern's ultimate is pretty much going to be an insta-kill on whoever he gets. With the help of like Beastmaster and his passive, it will make his Winter's Curse very nice.
Yeah, that's the one thing that I was thinking of, that, yeah, Winter Wyvern's okay against Beastmaster lineups for both reasons. Like you said, the creep clear as well. Not the most popular hero on this patch, though. And the Forest with the Cold Embrace, it can set up for other skill shots. So the first one that comes to mind is like an Invoker Sunstrike, for example. Sure, maybe you save them from that immediate death, but there's always other stuff that can fly through that physical damage immunity. So Wings will go into the Tusk. Okay, another nice aggressive support. Man, Dazzle Tusk feels like last patch all over again. So much reset with these two heroes. You've got a Shallow Grave as well as that Snowball. So if somebody's a bit too overextended, if they get caught by that Infest Bomb, it's going to have two ways now to keep somebody safe. And, with just one, you can kind of crowd control the Tusk and then focus on other heroes. But it's going to be hard to control both the Tusk and the Dazzle. So securing some of those early kills actually might be a for DC here.
Can be a little bit of a telling sign to see Wings pick up a Tusk, because the first thing you think of is a Tusk, huh? Why not an Earth Spirit, let's say, who normally fills the spot of a Tusk and kind of replaced him altogether in this meta for the most part. Well, they must want something that Tusk has that Earth Spirit doesn't, which is not a whole lot. And one of the big things I could think of is what you mentioned, is the defensive aspect, the way of having the Snowball to bail someone out. So I wonder if Wings are going to be rallying all this defense around one mighty, meaty core player. I mean, there's an Alk. I mean, that's one nice thing to have. So, you get your armor synergy along with the Alk. Now you got a way to bail him out if he does get focus fired with the Tusk, and he's going to get a lot from the Beastmaster, obviously, with the passive there. So it's not going to be the end of the road. They're going to probably get something else to follow this one up. I imagine that the Elk could be in the mid lane, but it was an interesting thing to see them go for the Tusk over the Earth Spirit.
Yeah, no doubt. I do like this Wings draft, though. They've got some decent synergy. Just the Sigil with the Alchemist. One of the problems he has is he does get kited around, especially in that mid-game. So the Sigil make it a little bit easier for him to stick on targets. Of course, there's natural synergy between the Dazzle and the Alk, the Acid Spray buffing up Dazzle's damage, and also Dazzle just using a defensive weave on the Alchemist. He's notorious for having low armor, especially in that early game. So Dazzle's one of those heroes, once he hits 6, especially if he picks up like a Medallion, can help out the Alchemist quite a bit. So some synergy there, but final bans come out. DC take out the Huskar, I think definitely warranted here, and Wings ban out the Meepo that we talked about, so not a big surprise on that one. What does that leave for the mid lane for DC, though? I wonder what they have in mind for Wii, possibly Alina, Windranger, those two still possibilities, but oh man, Wings, they go with a little bit of the cancer here. Venomancer, their final pick.
That is an interesting final pick. Obviously, he's a Ags candidate, I guess, to go along with the Alchemist there, and it does seem like it's going to be a Venomancer in a core position. I don't foresee the Tusk taking the off lane here. This is going to be a very interesting start for Wings Gaming.
I think what this does is round out their damage types. They have a lot of physical damage with Beastmaster Alchemist, and now they have a lot of magical damage to go with it. And DC will settle on the Invoker, final pick. Okay, kind of the obvious choice to make it all the way through the pool here, but I don't know here, Cuddle Guy. I kind of like the Venno. I mean, now Wings have this really scary team fight where they've got big magic damage, a lot of slows so the Alchemist can follow up. They've got some at least one stun to initiate with the Beastmaster. A pretty well-rounded draft. DC, they've got some okay setup. I'm curious if this Invoker is going to be going Quas Wex or Quas Exor.
Yeah, I would. My impression would be it's going to be Wex for the crowd control. It doesn't seem like they have enough to pair together with a Sunstrike, except for the Lion and his lockdown, which isn't the best right out of the gate, and you probably want to preserve it a bit more. And yeah, I guess the benefit of the Alacrity is also going to be very nice, though, to have with your Lifestealer. He's already going to be getting the Surge and the Ion Shell, a lot behind the Lifestealer on this one. But yeah, can't help but be intrigued about this Venomancer. I would put it to these two teams to pull out some of the already of the more fresher picks in their first game of the whole major.
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely a fair point. Looking at the Wings lineup, if this game ends up going long, you know, 45, 60 minutes plus, will we really start seeing this Alchemist pulling Aghanim Scepters? There are some options for Wings. Dazzle, definitely a hero that can benefit. You know, Weave does scale pretty well towards that late game. Venomancer, like you talked about. Tusk Eggs, a little gimmicky. You know, Walrus Kick sometimes can come in handy, sort of like a glorified Force Staff. So there are some possibilities here. And also the Beastmaster Eggs. I would say a little bit underwhelming relative to, you know, like the Necro Book, the BOTs, the Blink Dagger, the other core items that a Beastmaster goes for. So there is some scalability for Wings here, and I think there will come a point in the late game where they might be able to just outmass DC, where the Lifestealer just can't quite keep up. Though at the same time, Lifestealer pretty good against Alchemist in those one-on-one man mode type scenarios. So this should be a pretty interesting game. I don't think one team has a clear outdraft here by any stretch.
I can't help but get the early impression that this might be more of a quiet game at the start. I don't feel like these are too many aggressive roaming around supports, with the exception of Tusk, but his pairing in the lanes doesn't really offer a whole lot of kill potential unless you really have a lot of finesse and execution going your way, timed out, concoction stuns maybe from Alchemist, Weaver without a stun, just kind of his slow. I mean, you better hope that between that and a good shard block, that would be enough to get something going your way. But for the most part, between, you know, Wings, as mentioned, and DC, where you have your Darkseer who needs to build up a mech, a Lifestealer has quite the build up, and then, you know, it feels like they're not going to be fighting too much right away. And a slower paced game, I feel like, would benefit Wings, because, you know, with having this Alchemist, they have time on their side to kind of really push the farm. It's on DC to kind of make sure they address the Alk and don't allow Wings to have a wonderful start.
Absolutely. I'm also very curious what build this Alk is going to go for. If we're going to see like the Armlet into Blink, you know, maybe like a Solar Crest, very active Alchemist that fight, knock down some towers, get involved with the team, or if it's just going to be that, hey, I'm going to rush Radiance, you know, go for my Octarine core, take over the map, and then we're just going to hit when the timing is right, and we get all that yummy farm. I think one thing that'll be good for Wings is, presumably, this is a safe lane Venomancer. They've got a couple ways they could set up these lanes, but it looks to me like off lane Beastmaster, Venno in the safe lane, and then Alchemist in the mid, and if that's the case, Shadow should be able to get a lot of farming. We've seen, not even just on this patch, but throughout the past couple, how devastating a Venomancer can be. If he gets a fast Blink, Veil, Ags, I mean, that trio of items turns this hero into just a mobile kamikaze that can do insane mid-game.
It really is disgusting. And the thing is, you know, we've even seen teams pull it out offline. I mean, we've seen him in every position in the book. And the fact of the matter is, like, when you commit to get a kill on a Venomancer, once he gets that level 6, you're going to be putting in a lot of work just to take him down. And usually he'll get his Poison Nova off. So by the time you take him down, even if you felt like you bursted him down right away, you're going to be walking away pretty weak and wounded. And by that point, you usually need to round up, you know, sustain up a bit, pop your mech, you know, or just go back to the fountain. And that was all just for one kill. And usually by then, the rest of the team is already pre-plotting their next split push or a way to kind of pull out their own counter fight where Venno had just done his job. So he's fine to be going down at that point. So I am anxious to see if it's enough of attention that Wings should prioritize in getting the Ags to get the most out of that kamikaze effect, or if they prioritize it a bit differently. I happen to pull up one of their recent games with a Venomancer. Everything else paired with it's not the same of what we're seeing in this game, but sure enough, in that game, it was a very, you know, it was Shadow again, and it did have a lot of utility with it. He got an early pipe, but eventually did get the Ags and even a Veil to kind of add on top of it here. So pretty disgusting magic damage.
Yeah, absolutely. It seems like both these teams actually like Dazzle. I'm also browsing through the recent game history of DC, and there are a couple Dazzle games that pop in from time to time, so glad to see the Shadow Priest still getting some love. Misery with the manor question mark here. Hopefully Alchemist isn't having too big of a tech issue. This is a rocky start for our opening match here.
Shanghai all over again, dude. You might as well just stop it now. Yeah, that's
how
it is.
No.
But, as you mentioned, this is just one of four different matches happening at once, and I suppose after this point, the matches kind of don't become as simultaneous. Is it just the first two rounds?
Yeah, it's always the opening round. Today and tomorrow, we'll be having the three and four streams to provide some additional coverage. I think it's actually literally just the opening where they have four at once. Right now, it is OG versus Empire, Newbie versus Complexity, and, of course, Secret versus Navi. So I believe today is groups A and B, and coming up tomorrow will groups C and D. A lot to look forward to over the next few days, man. So much Dota 2 to come.
I am so excited. Just a blast of Dota. If you love Dota, then you're in for a magical treat this coming week.
I hope my sleep schedule can handle it. That's the only problem here with this. Yeah. The Manila Major, it's literally a 12-hour time difference for me, so it's I'm going nocturnal for the next week, I guess.
All right, so apparently, to go along with the audio issues, they are not letting Wings... they have a mic that can't send voice, and they say they can't play without headphones. There's obviously been some, you know, concerned folks in the past. I have seen at events a lot of these Chinese teams do like to play without their headphones on.
Yeah, but it's not even just China. It's kind of the Asian cultures in general. I know it's like that in C. A lot of it just comes from the LAN cafe culture, where they're all, you know, they play near each other, and they're just sort of built into the culture as a lot of kind of that no-tail style. You know, a lot of communication, a lot of hype, a lot of yelling. And they make a lot of noise, man. They yell over the ambient noise. I guess it is... got to be a change. You're used to that environment, and then you show up and they're like, all right, noise canceling headphones on, microphones out. It's a little bit different, but they've solved their issue. We're going to be able to resume here, so that's good.
Let's get this party started now. So for DC Wings, the odds books have this one pretty even. I would bank that Wings are going to be the more polished team coming into this one. They have a bit more experience playing with more international teams and kind of getting around the block, and have also chimed in a fair... I mean, both these teams have been grinding out a lot of games.
Yeah,
in a lot of qualify. I mean, probably some of the most games in this whole tournament. I would not be surprised. I mean, you see teams like Secret and EG just kind of coasting into these majors, but they've only played like two best of threes or something like that, I feel like, before they've gotten to this point. So these teams are warmed up and ready for this meta.
Yep, Wings pop a smoke early on here. Not going to do too much, but all these early wards come down. Dire get one in the Radiant offlane, as well as on the plateau here near the Radiant Ancients. And Radiant going to get a couple servers down just in that bottom river. They'll get one near the entryway to their safe lane, and then in the mid lane here where the Invoker will be. DC all grouped up. Here's where they're going to go here. Are we going to see a potential skirmish around these bounty runes? You don't see it too often, but right now Wings do have that vision advantage. I mean, a little bit of intel on the positioning of DC, so they have a fairly good idea of how these movements could go. They're grouped up about the bottom rune too. See what DC does.
Wings,
it looks like they will just go top.
They have that they have that mid lane ward here. It's just out of the range of that sentry that DC put down, so they think that they're clear right now, but Wings obviously have the idea of what's going on. We're not going to be seeing any sort of early skirmishes. I've noticed that a lot of teams like to be polite at the start of the game, except for the European, specifically the CIS region. They will gladly trade blows before the bounty rune will get underway. But
it is kind of strange. You know, on this patch, they changed it so it doesn't give experience now. And I remember the theory crafting at the hub, thinking about, well, you know, maybe they're going to start changing up who gets the runes. Maybe they'll start fighting over them. And it's like, nope, gentlemen's agreement. kids. Gonna go one for one, I would say, in like 80% of the games I've cast over the past month.
Sometimes, though, you'll get that one team that there's a five-man smoke and they wrap up and around behind the Ancients waiting for that, you know, oh, I'm just the mid laner, I'm gonna get my free rune. Yeah, that... they'll get one dirty tactic like that. That's the closest to excitement since we don't see as many level 1 Roshas anymore.
Yep. You know, this offlane Beastmaster in a world of hurt already. Soxa, as well as Misery, harassing him quite hard here. The Arctic Burn actually bringing him low. Sunstrike connects. One more auto attack. Misery's going to dive it. Misses the stun. And now he's almost going to go down himself. Just barely survives. Down to 2 HP. Creeps can't quite finish him off, and Faith Beyond will go ahead and eat that salve and get picked back up. Now in the bottom lane, Mu taking some damage as Innocence comes walking on in. They've got the double slow. They know he's only level 1. No surge out, and it's a first blood for Wings. Dazzle gets that bonus gold.
Oh, real unfortunate for DC. You could tell that the way they put all that into that gank that they were hoping to walk away with that first blood here, but it's Wings who get it done. Bottom lane doesn't feel like a duo that would be able to have a lot of kill potential. I even mentioned it in the draft, but you know, they have enough to shut down Mu before he can even get close enough for the level 2, and that's really all he wants. Once you get the level 2, you got the surge and you can get out of trouble, especially if all you have to work with is the slow and maybe a shard block. But they zone him back, they pull the lane away, he can't get the XP, and now he's really in a world of hurt, and he has to go to plan B, which is in the jungle.
Yeah, I think this is the right idea, though. At least jungle to get level 2 so you can show your face in lane, and maybe give them an opportunity towards the tower. They're going to stack up in the jungle, and most of this is going to be going towards the Alchemist. Already a triple stack at that medium camp there in the middle, and it looks like that's it for now. But a key part of the Alchemist's strat, making sure he has some stacks to rely on so that he can get that huge boost to farm in the early game. Now up top again, right in onto the Beastmaster. Looks like DC will have the damage this go around. Resolution goes into the Rage form, and he'll get credit for this kill on Faith Beyond. That makes it 1-1 as DC get up on the scoreboard.
Good read right there by DC to recognize Beastmaster far out of position. They do still have that deep ward to kind of check out the pull camp, but they really didn't know if he was going to be committing that deep. And once they recognized it, Wyvern, of course, Soxa was in a beautiful position to catch him from behind. And he's been doing a good job putting that curse to use every time it is off cooldown. So that gets him back up and ahead and tries to get this game back even once more for him. And we'll just have to recognize, you know, the mid lane matchup, 14-5 for the Invoker. Alchemist still hanging with them, though. And DC are going to have to make sure they do keep tabs on where these bounties will pop up if they want to nerf his gold gain.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see if DC can make a movement into the enemy jungle once Alchemist starts to go for these stacks. We've seen that in the past where it can be a way to steal a lot of farm from the Alk, slow his roll, and get a little bit of farm for your team, but often easier said than done. When you're deep in enemy territory, sometimes they can converge on you and you're left out high and dry. So that'll be coming up in a couple minutes here. But for now, the quiet laning phase resumes. Mu heads back down bottom. He found his level 3 in the jungle, gets that second point in Ion Shell, gets a big boost in damage. Goes back to Leech XP,
lane,
back
though,
in the top
they're
lane.
They're going for Faith. They get the open wounds, but they don't have enough lockdown to stop. And it will force out a rotation from the Dazzle, but very close. And they make sure they continue to bully Faith here quite a bit.
Yeah, good positioning from Innocence to TP in like that. He was level 3, actually didn't skill up the Grave, so minor win for him there. Kind of taunting them like, don't worry guys, I've got Grave. I'm going to save him if you commit for this. But didn't actually have to skill it up, so maybe he can find a kill elsewhere. Bounty rune up top. Alchemist has been 3 for 3 so far on these bounty runes. He is living the dream as Soxa gets pushed back. Soxa.
Don't call him Soxa, man. Apparently
I know.
He'll get you. I have to learn it really good because he's definitely, they're coming to the summit, so I dare not say that to his face.
Yeah.
Bottom lane, shard block on the Mu. They keep trying their best now that they can give this Darkseer a difficult time, but obviously ever since Mu's picked up his surge, he's been a lot more comfortable being near the lane, and his grind toward that mech can begin, because for DC, for the most part, unless they can get some more cutesy Sunstrike setups, they have to wait for this mech before they can really go on the objective path, I would feel.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. DC will probably be a little bit quiet until Invoker really starts to come online, kind of like you're talking about here. What's he got on the Courier? That's just his Gloves of Haste, so waiting for that recipe to Pandemitis as Darkseer just trying to farm his hard camp here. We'll get intercepted by Ice, being to leech some of the XP. Tusk, one of the lowest levels in the game, only 2 right now. He's off to kind of a slow start. He did pick up that first assist, just Oob and Brown Boots for any opportunity to find some extra experience.
It's like one of the things I was also curious to see this game. It's like Tusk is definitely kind of just fallen out of fashion for most people, and You know, again, like I said, you know, why go for him when you have access to something like the awesome Earth Spirit? But we do remember being Tusk a bit more bloodthirsty at the start. He's flirting a bit with Moo to make sure he doesn't get anything too easy. But, you know, you don't want to get into that bounty hunter syndrome where you're doing nothing and you end up leading to nowhere. Top lane, does look like they have the open wounds for Faith, but they're looking to turn it around as Innocence does innocently step in with the poison touch, but it looks like the situation will defuse.
Yeah, this Dazzle's been really eager to support the Beastmaster and make sure that he doesn't get ganked and shut down too hard, and it's kind of working. It's allowing him to stay a little more forward in the lane. He's halfway through level 4. We see some Beastmasters now, and they struggle like this in the offlane. Just go straight to the jungle. Still play that 3 role, but farm as if you're on the 4, and he seems dedicated to this offlane, and I think some of that is because they want to leave that jungle farm for the Alchemist, but the Dazzle's positioning is making this work for Wings. Looking at the charts, they do have a minor lead. About 750 net worth, experience is even, but hey, that's not bad for 6 minutes in, given that it is all tied up 1-1 and no towers have fallen yet. That's just straight CS in the lanes.
I feel like as long as things are just passively going the way they are, I mean, Wings will just win the farm game with the power of the Alp. So obviously it is on DC to kind of maybe change the tempo of things, whether it's, as you mentioned before, shake things up, go into that Wings woods, find those stacks, take them for yourself. I'm sure Moo would love them. I mean, he just got to walk in and get a simple Iron Shell. He's eyeballing a stack right here next to him. But as that happens, top lane, I'm looking at a little bit of flirty play. As they make a move for Faith, the Sunstrike comes in. Very nice connection is going to be there, but look who it is. It's Dazzle. This time he has a Grave good to go.
Yep, Innocence for the third time. He actually has to use the Grave this time, but still great stuff for him. And that serves as kind of a distraction for DC, because all the while, Alchemist is in the jungle. He farms up this big stack at the medium camp, and that almost secures his armlet. He's damn close, just one piece away. Meanwhile, on the other side of it, Moo trying to take out this stack of his own. He's got the Ion Shell up, so just doing some pretty good damage here, but in comes Big Bad Alchemist. He's going to start going for the cleanup and get that Grievous Greed going. He is in great shape now, 4,700 net worth. They're going to go in onto Moo. The Surge goes off, but now the Snowball forward. He's going to lose his Surge soon. He's still slowed up from the Venno. Venno actually doesn't want to commit for it. They see the TPs coming in. Ice may get left behind. He's going to try to run through the trees, but it won't happen. Zoxka TPs in. And they'll just get a quick kill on the Tusk. Okay, not bad for DC. Alchemist still clears up the stack, so I guess not really bad for Wings either, but at least they do get a counter kill the other way.
Yeah, I mean, it does force a couple of rotations down. Ice was very thirsty to get that kill. You know, as mentioned before, he is a Tusk at the end of the day, and you're hoping to kind of get your hands dirty. He's not the best farmer, and there's not really a place for him to farm at the moment. So his best chance at getting some bursted XP or gold before the tomes do come out is to simply try to find some kill opportunities. They thought they had one there in Moo, but he was too close to the tower. The rotations came, and yes, DC got the kill. Does mean that Beastmaster doesn't have to worry about too many threats in the meantime, so he can coast his way to level 6, which is nice, because Wings can't wait for when the Roar comes online mid to have lane. Some good kill potential. But mid lane, it looks like Wii's going to be forced into dishing out an Ice Wall to avoid trouble.
This is one of those scenarios where the Alchemist is just wishing he had one point in Unstable Concoction. He picked up an Invis Rune, which made that whole setup possible, and I think just one stun there from him would have made that kill a possibility, but they didn't quite have the lockdown, and Wii is able to walk away. And kind of unfortunate timing for Wings. He was right on the cusp of his Hand of Midas, and because he survives there, he will get the gold for it, and has a nicely timed 9-minute Midas delivered to him right there in the jungle where he can start grabbing creeps. Gets up pretty happy Invoker, all things considered.
Yeah, I mean, he's making good time as it is right now, but eventually they will need to make sure they can keep these Wings in check right now and prepare for what could be upcoming trouble. How is Moo doing for his mech? He's got the Headdress, but still needs quite a bit of a build-up. He's borrowing some of these stacks and, you know, is just sharing the jungle. There's 3 people from DC at the moment actually farming the jungle right here, so not a lot of lane presence. Could get Wings a bit nervous. Looking at the Wings' vision, they have some, but, you know, they are kind of going to have to watch out for DC to continue to wait in the dark. It looks like they're going to be committing a scan and see if any ancient camps are being done. No, but they will spot out Zoxka, who is rotating through.
Yeah. Well, things looking pretty good for Wings overall. Shadow in the safe lane is going to go for Veil first item. We spent a little bit of time theory crafting the different possibilities for Venomancer. Interesting to see him go for Veil first. I would have thought that this item build works a little better when there's more magic damage synergy across your team, and here everyone else is doing pretty heavy physical, a little magic here and there, but that item is mostly just for him and all of his big damage. So we'll see what he goes for next, if it's a Blink Dagger for mobility, if he tries to go right into the Ags. A lot of possibilities, but one thing is for sure, this Venomancer is getting quite a bit of farm out of the safe lane. Now we'll see Wings smoke up. They're going to rotate around the Roche Pit and move into this bottom lane. Moo nearby, as is Misery. They ping out the Lion. So this is going to be the target they go on. Snowball in. It's too deep behind the tower. Lion without enough mana to drop the finger, but Resolution's here. He TPs in. Nice stun from the Lion. Sets it up onto Ice Ice. It's actually the Beastmaster that falls first, but it's a 2-0. Wings not going to find the easy gank they were hoping for, getting a bit too ambitious with that one. And Shadow not even out of the clear yet. Resolution getting slowed down by the Plague Wards will just turn, throw out a few right clicks, and that's where it will end, is just a 2-0. But DC, got to be happy with that. They level out that net worth chart.
The deep commitment from Wings is easily punished by some swift rotations coming out from DC, and they avoid a lot of that teleport time too. And Venomancer's there, but it really doesn't feel like he's there. He doesn't have Poison Nova yet. I mean, I understand you skip over because of its ridiculous mana commitment, but you know, just simple wards and stuff and a hopeful right click might not be enough to kind of get the kill you're looking for there. And once they roll in, they get nice and close, but the damage output is just not there at the moment. And that is the Wings Gaming Roar debut of the game, and not what you're hoping for at this moment, but easily can kind of try to make up for it by some space and some time and some continued farm on Alchemist, who is really your insurance policy. He already has a freaking relic, by the way.
Yeah, Brown Boots armlet right into Radiance. A really well-rounded build. Gives him some sustainability in lane, some just extra stats in general, and now he's just going to go right for that big farming tool. He has been so lucky with these bounty runes, and here he's going to walk right into another one. The luck continues for this guy. Now just 500 off that Radiance recipe. Yep, a lot of eggs in that Alchemist basket right now, and Wing's kind of on the cusp. The next 5 to 10 minutes are going to be really telling as how this game continues. If he continues at this rate of farm, he will just take over this game, but there's still a pretty good window where DC can gank and put that pressure on. And speaking of ganks, they're going to smoke up and come down bottom onto Shadow. Venomancer tucked nicely behind his tier 1 tower. Going to be an awkward angle to try and start this fight, but with a Lion stun, make this happen.
They'll need rotations. Dazzle has one TP right now, but he's the only other person with a TP at the moment if they make a die for Shadow. No Poison Nova. Yeah, Veil. Only level 1 Venomous Gale, though, at the moment here.
Yeah,
he'll definitely make him work for it, but he's doing a nice job. And yeah, the benefit of having these wards is you can just drop them over the trees, and hey, that's a gank over there trying to come for me. So they will now be prepped and ready, and DC just kind of stuck waiting on the sidelines, grabbing the little breadcrumbs of farm that are nearby.
Really good positioning from Shadow in general there. Realizing that there were a few heroes missing off the map, feeling that there could be some trickery afoot, he just hides very calmly in these difficult-to-reach locations where they don't want to commit for that kind of a gank, and he'll just TP out, smoke up with his friends, and now they're on the hunt. The Radiance is online for the Alchemist, so he's turbo-farming in the jungle, and you know, that space created down bottom. Every second that Wings can make for this Alchemist to farm, they're going to take, as long as it doesn't mean they have to throw away bodies. They're going to smoke through the enemy jungle. Not going to find a hell of a lot here. Moon up in the top lane between the tier 1 and the tier 2. They may just turn this into a tier 1 tower push if they don't find anyone else.
Yeah, it looks like it here. They were trying to use the impression that Shadow could have been still hanging at the bottom lane and went on the smoke journey, but they found themselves still in a good position above where Misery is, so they make their commitment in. Ice Ice is going to get hexed up and look to focus them. That's the finger, that's the kill, but they get a roar off, and that's going to take Misery down. A one-for-one trade. Stoxa right in the middle of it all gets off a big curse. Not enough to finish him off, but the vacuum combo comes out with Whee's Meatball, and that does some good work. Alchemist gets in the grind, gets off a couple of kills, but it does look like it's going to be DC at the end of the day here. Faith trying to run and make it away from trouble right now, and the chase is still on, and it looks like he might have created enough space for himself to make it away from danger.
Yeah, I think Faith Beyond going to be able to live here, but a huge fight for DC. 8-3 now. Really the first big team fight of the game, knowing that the Alchemist still isn't really the unstoppable force that has control of the game yet. about a 1,300 net worth swing or so, and they did lose their Dark Seer and Lion, so it wasn't a flawless fight. Looks like the Lifestealer just moving into an Echo Saber off that, so a sign that DC may turn up the aggression a little bit. It's usually an item you pick up on a hero like Lifestealer when you want to fight in the here and now, gives you some great stats. Not the best farming tool if you're just going to be AFK in the jungle, so... I think DC are going to start ganking, maybe start to use those Infest Bombs a little more with the Lion. He's very close to his blink, 1,900 gold right now. So, wow. We'll see. Also, that mech that we've been talking about on Mu, he's just a couple hundred gold off.
Yeah, I think that fight is just going to give DC a huge boost in morale right now. I think that they can recognize that they are going to be winning some of these team fights as long as they play with the cooldowns they have, which, to be honest, their team doesn't have a whole lot of crazy cooldowns to work with. Finger is pretty high right now. It eventually will kind of fall off a bit once he gets some levels under his belt, but you know, outside of that and the wall, they have great opportunities to make some big team fights happen if they continue to play that game. I mean, I don't imagine they want to play more of this counterfight game where you hope that Wings continues to smoke into your turf and you happen to catch them off in a better fight. Maybe instead being more proactive. It might just be the mech coming online that will decide that or not. But for Wings, yep. Their Alchemist, he's got his ruby red shoes, boots of travel online now. So his farm potential will continue to rise. But we'll just have to see how much farm he's going to be available to him once DC decide to turn it up.
Yeah, and DC now holding on to about a 2k net worth lead, somewhere about 4,500 experience edge, so it is sizable, but still a ways to go before they close this one out. I have a feeling they're just waiting for this Misery Blink Dagger. He's now 30 gold away. He picks up a smoke. They might just wait for the passive gold gain and stop by the side shop at this point. You know, pick up that teleportation dagger. Wings at it once more. They're actually going to smoke up themselves and again have a go into the enemy territory, but DC nowhere to be found. They're split up in the lanes with most of their forces down bottom.
Faith did not have the book last time. He has level 1 now. He's actually, unfortunately, a bit under farm for a Beastmaster where you like to be. Now, there's going to be the snowball roll. They go for Wii. Sentry's going to be dropped. It's enough of a vision that they can get the roll in, or the roar rather, but a vacuum pull out from Mu. Iron Shell rolling forward. Now that's going to be the wall commitment. They'll finally get Weeha down, but a beautiful turnaround from DC as they wipe the floor and take out 3.
Wow.
Hard commitment from Wings, and they continue to get punished.
Yeah, Tusk does get the Invoker, but absolutely not worth it there. It seemed so eerily similar to what we saw in this bottom lane behind the Tier 1 tower just 5 minutes ago, where they dove so deep, and it was a pretty easy reaction for DC. Honestly, all they had to do was TP and rotate in, and it was pretty clear that Wings were way overcommitted. Again, I guess you can say it's Space Creator for the Alchemist. His net worth is continuing to skyrocket. He's already got a Vitality Booster and another 1,300 gold, but you know, I think they can create similar amounts of space without throwing away 1-for-3 trades in such an aggressive manner like that.
Yeah, they're definitely playing it as if they need to get these kills. I mean, I feel like they could definitely afford to kind of play with the clock a bit, but I know they made this commit for the Tusk, and they're probably hoping to kind of get more bloodshed going their way, but for each opportunity they think they have at a gank, it continues to just make life better for DC, and now they're picking up even more free gold on the map. A tier 1 in the bottom lane will be going down, and already we have a Sage in the pocket here. Poor resolution waiting back at the base, so
yeah,
their Roche potential is also coming online very nicely here, and they still hold a couple of tier 1s to get access to. DC are in great control of this game right now.
Yeah, even though the Lifestealer is behind by 3 or 4k net worth, I think Resolution's been farming very well considering he doesn't have a true farming tool, you know, no Midas or anything. Given that he's gone for these kind of combative items that allow him to get involved in these early skirmishes, he's really kept tempo pretty nicely. 4-0-4, hasn't died yet this game, and overall had a pretty good showing. They're going to move into enemy territory and just clear out a couple of these camps in the jungle and start to take away just some of that map control from Wings. Right now it is 2-0 in total tower count, DC taking out the tier 1 mid and the tier 1 bottom, so that does open up the radius jungle a little bit and limit some of the space where Wings can safely farm.
Yeah, it just feels awkward with like having Shadow doing ancient camps right now. That feels like not something that was originally planned for them to having to do right now, but they're definitely pushing for it. He's got a staff here, not sure if that's going to be building into a second book or a four staff. But nonetheless, another AGs. Utility to have, or yeah, just the AGs, maybe a single component for the AGs. But they definitely feel off that where they want to be right now. While DC seemed peaked and ready to take a fight here, they got here Misery go. At the moment with his blink smoked up. He's got the bomb, that's the pop, that's the blow up, and that's the kill. Ice goes easy. Down, and DC make it look easy.
Absolutely. That's the power of the Lion Lifestealer duo. We've seen it a lot, and for good reason. Dazzle in a precarious situation here, perhaps, holding the high ground, but not too many places to go if they find him. He does have a grave TP, be the one solace to get out here, but Wing's going to have to take another pause.
So Bolt. Cold. Oh, that's unfortunate. The AC's blasting a bit too hard. Well, Manila, it's like, what, stupid humid
super
apparently
hot.
Out there. Like,
yeah.
Super humid, super hot. It's like walking through oatmeal or something, so I mean, really got to have, like...
That's what it was like in Kuala Lumpur in Malaysia. Like, I didn't bring enough clothes because I didn't expect to completely sweat through two sets of clothes per day. I mean, it's insane. You spend 5 minutes outside and you feel like you just got out of the shower or something. It's just so humid.
And so I suppose they're probably blasting the AC where they are right now. Like, sir, it's just so cold. I can't get my blink dagger off, you know?
Yeah. It's a problem. It's hard to play with cold fingers. I will attest to that. Vascularization. It's serious, man. It harbors that gaming ability.
While we're in a pause, I'll ask you the question. I think I saw on the pre-show before we got started what the community voted for and what the English broadcast panel fell for were like the top teams right now. They had laid them out, all of them. But what do you think are going to be the top two teams right here?
Top two? Ooh, God. I don't know about top two, but I do actually think DC could have a pretty good run here. They're a team that I think a lot of people have slept on because they've had so many funky rosters that the brand is like, oh, DC, the team that doesn't qualify for majors. And this lineup is just, like, they're carrying so much momentum into the major. I think that's really important. Top two would be crazy. I think it's possible, but unlikely for them to do it. Liquid, I think, is a pretty safe bet for top two. Recent results, momentum as well. I would definitely, if I was a betting man, I think Liquid will be pretty high on my list. And honestly, EG, I haven't seen too much of them recently. They're one of those teams, kind of like Secret, that keeps it pretty close to the vest. You know, they don't play in too much outside of the majors and various other big tournaments. But, you know, the boys in blue, I think they're always a potential favorite coming into this stuff.
Yeah, I could agree with that. For DC's, for the side of DC, I mean, obviously the stigma is just... They've only been playing in NA, and, you know, does that mean a whole lot as far as where they stand and internationally ranked? They have taken down Complexity every time, though, and we've seen Complexity pull out huge series and huge games in their recent international lands, you know, taking down Alliance and pulling out, like, what, top fives? But, I don't know. I feel like DC will probably have their best tournament run they've had so far, but I don't know if I would see them yet in top five. I would be happy to be surprised.
Yeah, and I know EG, you know, that Complexity bested them not so long ago, and that they might be kind of an odd pick there, but I think PPD as a drafter is really good when he has more time to figure out patches. You know, once he gets more data and more time to analyze the competition, I think that's where EG starts to shine really well.
Yeah.
So it's been a long enough window now where I would be shocked if PPD doesn't have a few tricks up his sleeve coming into this tournament.
They do need to get hands-on, though. I always feel like that's always how EG is. Like, they won TI, and then what happened after that? They went to ESL New York, and they bombed out there, and then they did mediocre at a tournament after that, and then, of course, they finished somehow top three or whatever at the following major and stuff. So EG has that same factor that Secret do where, you know, they always have these shaky performances that the LAN's moving in where they decide to pick, like, one or two of them before a big Valve event, and then they get to the Valve event and they suddenly just surprise everybody and they do finish in, like, the top two, three spot. This EG team, it's, you know, I want to say, like, oh, I don't see it happening again, but technically it's four out of the five TI winners, so, you know, they've done it before.
Yeah, it's true. You know, the team that I always have a big question mark with is OG. You know, they obviously have really high skill individuals. Sometimes they look hot, sometimes they look cold. They had, what was it, a third place finish at Epicenter. And looked pretty
they
good
won
over
Dream League, right?
Na'Vi at Dream League. Yeah, and it was a sweep, too. I think it was a 3-0 finals. Like,
they were
convincing,
definitely
so.
Like on another level compared to the other teams at Dream League. Like,
yeah.
It felt very obvious being there. But it was just like, okay, OG are just very good. I could see the top. We're back in the game, Alchemist. Andrew, and Alchemist is dead, potentially.
Oh, he's actually going to survive through. He's going to regen up as well. Now they may turn on to Misery. He's going to TP home. Resolution hangs around to go blow for blow with the Alchemist. Shallow Grave comes out, and DC decide to get out of here. Soxa on the high ground. We'll just fly back to safety. And after all that, some blood is shed, but no deaths. And everybody does make it out. So, all right, you're right. We are back in this game after a pretty long pause. So we'll reacquaint ourselves. About 3,500 net worth lead, 7,500 experience lead. Digital Chaos right now, they're in pretty good shape, but as you can see by the net worth drop down, this Alchemist is still farming damn well. He picked up that Vitality Booster, now has a full Manta style to go with his BOT Radiance Armlet, but DC just moved right into the Roche Pit. You pointed this out not so long, KG, that their Roche potential is quite strong, especially with Alacrity on the Lifestealer, and they're going to take advantage here.
Should be able to get it without much contention. Wings may even know this is happening, so they'll try to go for their own casual trade, which will be that top tier one tower. Still alive if there does want to be a rotation, but there will not be. But Wings will just continue to farm as it is. I mean, they might even kind of be in the mindset that they're expecting to lose potential tier twos in the near future because of this Aegis, but they're definitely not at critical mass yet, where they would like to be. On this Alchemist, obviously they would love for Faith to be able to get his book 3 together. I'm sure they would even anticipate a Blink Dagger to have that as a follow-up. So DC, if they want to keep a way to stay in the positive, they got to go, and they just need to make sure that they can make sure Wings don't have opportunities to farm and allow this Alchemist to be a beast.
Yeah, definitely. And DC's going to do that. SNY coming out on the Lifestealer, so he's still getting these great combative items that give him an edge in the here and now. Weave from the Dazzle comes out, connects on two, and DC will just retreat. I think pretty happy to force a reaction like that with just two heroes as they see the Alchemist in the mid and open up the map a little bit more. Yeah,
just
they've still got a pretty
DC
good window.
Lanes.
But I think with this Aegis is where they really want to make it happen and start clearing out these tier 2 towers.
I mean, without question, a fight will be coming with this Aegis here, but it looks like they're going to wait for the stars to align first. Because you're kind of stuck in a predicament, maybe you're looking to finish off your next big item before you take this fight, but at the same time, you don't want to allow the Alk to continue farming up, because for every extra, I need just 300 gold here, he's going to quickly throw together another 1,000 towards his big item. So you got to get what you need fast. It could be on resolution here with 1,000 to his name at the moment. They continue their move, but it's actually Wings making their move. Bottom lane, a four-staff initiation, going to be swiftly avoided by Misery. He blinks straight back and creates some space from Trouble. But Ice should get the vision. No, not able to get close enough. The darkness is out, and he cannot get the snowball off.
Yeah, nighttime saving Misery's life there for sure. It's almost like Misery sensed that was coming. He was farming in a pretty aggressive position. There were a lot of Wings heroes missing off the map. DC pretty dark in the enemy jungle, actually no wards down. So he had his finger on the trigger, and he reacts just in the nick of time as that Veil was coming out. It is interesting that Shadow seems to prioritize the Force Staff over Blink Dagger. I think he mentioned in his match history that goes for some of those utility tools. So 2,000 gold, that's about halfway to an Aghanim's if that's the route he wants to go. But could also just try to tank up himself. I also want to point out the Darkseer build. He went right into Pipe after Mech, and Moose actually got it completed. That's a huge item pickup here. Kind of counteracts the effect of the Veil on the Venomancer.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I know it was pointed out that he's pretty much the only person that can take the most advantage of that Veil, but it's enough to force DC to itemize appropriately for it. If that's what it does, then I think Wings are going to be happy about it. It's one step further from being at your Blink Dagger on your Darkseer, but now that DC do have the Pipe, I mean, they don't need to worry about Venomancer whatsoever, and I have yet to see his impact in this game, and that Pipe is not going to make a good case for him here forward. So here comes DC, though. Easy tier 2, but Faith does jump in, gets the roar off for Misery. That's going to be the Veil Pop. Shadow wiggles his way in, gets off, but they counteract it with their own Vacuum Wall combo here. And now Wings need to readjust, but now the damage begins to tick forward, and DC could begin to crumble. They will lose Moo, and makes it a 2-for-0 trade at the moment, as a DC kind of second guess a commitment in for a round two, but it looks like they'll opt to kind of withdraw and get the hell out of there.
A great hold from Wings. The tower stays standing with 29 HP, so that'll be an easy deny for them as they retreat back. BKB on the way for Weeha. Always hard to tell exactly what happens in those team fights. For whatever reason, a Darkseer Vac wall always makes the servers lag a little bit when you're in America and you're on either Singapore or Perfect World servers. But appeared to be a pretty clutch grave from the Dazzle. Innocence keeping Faith alive and actually hitting the threshold there. Also worth mentioning, this Beastmaster going for a different build. He rushed the level 1 Necronomicon and then actually stopped off for a Blink Dagger rather than leveling it up. And I think way more commonly we're seeing Beastmasters go for the Book 3 primary and then get the Blink Dagger afterwards. So putting a little more stock in just the initiation power for Wings.
Yeah, and I think it's not much more than that. Pretty cut and dry case if they're obviously going to be favoring the initiation or maybe the disengage factor of the blink with quick reaction.
Yeah,
we saw a misery in the bottom lane just earlier, you know? Could save you from being caught out, which could happen here sooner than you expect. The board's going to spot it, and oh, he doesn't get the blink off those. All right, that's the problem if you don't have the quick reaction. They're going to catch him with the tornado, ice wall. He's not going anywhere, and they're going to get ice on top of it. There's the finish with the help of the Sunstrike, and quickly to go down. They will lose misery Lion though, and Resolution will have to pull off. Zoxa eating a lot of damage. Glimmer Cape will help keep him alive as the Mighty Alchemist thrusts on forward. There's the response move. Vacuum Wall combo catches out the Alk, and now they can use the power of the Alk against him. It forces him back. Both teams will separate here. It is DC who come out with a better hit, taking down the two.
Yeah, it looked like a really convincing fight for DC at first, but a 2-for-1, not so bad for Wings. The Dazzle almost got bursted down, but he did just barely manage to grave himself and TP home to survive. He is hanging on to a Gem of True Sight, so that Dazzle kill actually would have been pretty huge for DC. Alk starting to show his power in these fights, though. He's getting harder and harder to kill. He's got the full Octarine core up now and the plate mail picked up. So either a Shiva's or the Assault Karas on the way for him, probably getting close to that territory where he'll want to replace that armlet for a bigger ticket item, you know, maybe a Heart of Tarrasque or Mjolnir or something like that.
I mean, after that, I mean, he's just a step away from buying the Ags for everybody, considering he gets a Moonshard for himself or not. But
yeah,
nonetheless, I mean, we already mentioned in the draft the Ags potential on this team. And, you know, I kind of scoffed it like, oh, if he gets to that point, most of these battle Alchemist builds usually require quite the build up and the game ends by the time he gets to, you know, critical mass. But he's surprisingly getting farmed pretty frickin' fast, and the game doesn't seem to be ending anytime soon. We will be seeing people with Agnum Scepter for sure, and that's just the high ceiling that he brings to your team.
Yeah, and I think Venno probably the first target to receive an Aghanim. Said he's definitely itemizing as if there's going to be one coming his way in the near future. He went Veil, Force Staff, now into the BKB. So slowing down on mobility, but just going for survivability. And now I'm pretty tempted to agree with you here. Even though Shadow's been farming okay, he's fourth on net worth, middle of the pack. Does feel like the Venno's presence in general has been pretty underwhelming this game. In the team fights, we haven't had that moment where it's like the Poison Nova. You know, has he even used it yet? I haven't even really noticed it in these team fights. If he has, the impact has been fairly minimal.
He got a good one off in that previous fight in the bottom lane
where they had the setup
and he forced himself in just to get off the big Venomous Gale. And at that point, you just hope its impact is going to be good enough for your Alk to clean up the mess that's left over with your Radiance, with your Acid Spray. So, you know, you just have to really take a look at the numbers, I suppose, at each of these fights to see what the impact actually is. But the nice thing is that he does bring more than just a Venomous Gale. He has that Force Staff now, and anything that helps you kite away from this Lifestealer is a big bonus. So, looks like they're making an approach bottom lane, though.
Here we go. The Alchemist goes in first. He has the Shiva's Guard that he just picked up. Resolution saved by the Cold Embrace, but Weeha with a fresh BKB goes in the front line. Speaking of the front lines, it's Ice in way too deep. He snowballed by himself. It's actually going to cost him his life, and now it's a 4v5. Venomous Gale falls short. Guardian Greaves and Pipe used by DC, and they're all pretty healthy. It's just a quick kill on the Tusk, and now DC want more. They're going to find Faith Beyond, Sunstrike off the mark, but now the Force Staff forward. They catch him with open wounds, the follow-up stun. Grave from Dazzle buys him some time. Now around the backside, Venno drops the ult. Again, a cold embrace on Mu buys him some time. He'll BKB. Beastmaster gets denied to a neutral, and Alchemist just destroys his own Dazzle. The gem hits the deck. It's a wonderful ult from Soxa. Now he's going to take a lot of damage, though. The Alk Illusion almost bringing him down. He gets another cold embrace off. Wings just don't have the damage. Alk tries to cut his losses and TP home, but he can't do it. Finger of Death is there. He does get the kill on the Winter Wyvern, but he is going down, and this fight will go in favor of DC. A 1-for-3. They did such a good job splitting the damage. Winter Wyvern ends up dying, but honestly, I think the MVP for that fight between the cold embraces and that sick Winter's Curse on the Dazzle.
I mean, that is one of the best ways you can use these Winter Curses, too. I mean, they've changed the way it works significantly, but moments like that when you're able to utilize their heavy-hitting core as your own weapon, and poor unfortunate Dazzle or anyone else who's in the wake of this Alchemist is just going to get shredded. And just, it's almost like a Doom. It's just an instant hero delete out of the fight, and it was just wonderfully used. But, I mean, they had to work very hard to get that Alchemist down. They are beaten and battered, and they had to pull away. You know, Imagine if Wings didn't have such a weird, awkward, stutter-stepping start. You can give credit to DC for that, though. We did a wonderful job zoning back most of the team with a brilliant ice wall. You know, the Venomancer, unfortunately, was a bit off the mark on catching a lot with the Gale, given that we did have a BKB, and, you know, this circles back to how effective this Venomancer actually is in the game overall. But considering the situation for Wings and how awkward of a start it was, that Alchemist almost walked away from that fight with a lot more kills under his belt. Next time, he's going to be even tougher to take on, so I don't know if it's easy street yet for DC.
It's true. I think a lot of that was just individually good plays from DC. That fight was really chaotic, and in this area where there's a lot of trees, a lot of places where you can move into fog and kind of reset, and DC just did a much better job. You saw the Winter Wyvern in that fight just literally playing ring around the rosy with these trees here, just trying to stay in fog around the Alchemist, and even though he ended up dying, he survived so long that it completely changed the state of the fight. Now DC scout out Roshan, and they're just going to walk right into the pit, and this will probably be another uncontested Rosh with the second Aegis going their way.
Yeah, Wings, if they can move their way through this top lane, can at least get a tower trade for it. The common trade we usually see between a Rosh and a tower at the top here, but I don't know if Wings are going to be too deterred by it. DC can now kind of dictate the pace of the game for a little bit here, having the benefit of the extra life, but again, playing it against an Alk, you have to really make sure you calculate how much time you actually need before you could put this Aegis to use. You don't want to be handing over too much time for this Alk to be dishing out that next Ags for the upcoming fight.
Yeah, no doubt about that. Interesting item choice here for Weehaw on the Invoker. He goes for a Sheila's Guard after Ag's BKB. We'll hold that thought as they go right in on the Beastmaster, and Fest Bomb gets him low, and the finger will finish him off. Now they go in on the Ice. He tries to TP home, but yeah, that's not happening. They've got an interrupt with the Cold Snap. Get another freebie on the Tusk, as well as an extra 100 gold bounty for finishing off that little summon he's got there, his Frozen Sigil.
Yeah, turns into just an easy two-man takedown. Doesn't delay a whole lot. The Beastmaster's got his Blink and Book 3, which is your essential tools. But for the Tusk, I mean, he's not very relevant in this game at this point. Would love to have a bit more to be able to survive. But speaking of item gains, it continues to work out nicely for DC. Mu, after completing his Greaves, has now picked up his Blink Dagger. So the setup potential is a lot better for DC, and their high ground defense becomes that much easier too. I mean, you already have a Darkseer as one of the best high ground defenders in the game, but if you really look at the lineup overall, DC have a hell of a high ground capability of holding. Choke point fighting between the Invoker, as mentioned, Darkseer, Winter's, you know, the Winter Wyvern with his Winter's Curse, with the way he could just fend off creep waves with his Splinter Blast. DC can play this one for the long haul. This could end up being a long game number one too.
Yeah, absolutely. For Wings, though, I have more trouble seeing their win condition. They don't really push that well. I mean, the only way they can break high ground is if they wipe DC outside of the base, and that's going to be easier said than done. We hop pretty far forward here. He's got a lot of time left on the Aegis, just about a minute and a half into that timer. They are going to try to bait with him and maybe let him fall before they come in, but no, on the back line, it's actually Misery that gets caught. It's raid initiation from Wings. They're going to go straight in with the snowball. Ice dies straight away. Face Beyond shortly after. Resolution just going completely ham in this fight. L trade 1-for-2 to get it started. That's where things will settle down. The Aegis of the Immortal still in tow on the Invoker, who is deep in the front lines.
It was a valiant bait on bait almost. DC gladly had Wii way out in front and were waiting in the back lines while Wings were trying this cheeky play coming up from the side here. Wii re-engages with the resolution bomb, but it's all for an illusion, so obviously that's going to be a swing and a miss. But they tried to make a jump from the side. They actually caught out Misery. It was just a one-man roar, though, and they bursted down the line. But then that didn't leave them with a whole lot of firepower for the follow-up fight. And it looked like Alchemist was quite hesitant on, you know, putting his own stake into the fight there. Maybe not comfortable being too far and away from the tower, but obviously it was not a situation Wings were hoping for.
Really good idea from DC to try and bait with the Invoker like that. Unfortunately, it seems like they almost forgot about the Beastmaster Hawk. That was what was flying over on the tree line and allowed Wings to have the vision to find that kind of initiation. But watching that fight, I feel like the biggest truth for this Wings lineup is the Tusk for me. I mean, that fight was good initiation. You just saw how quickly he died. I mean, I feel like his impact has just been so low this game. We'll see him go snowballing in onto Move, Primal Roar to follow up, but are they going to have the damage for this? Now Venomancer and Dazzle joining the party. Cold Embrace will heal him up a little bit. He still has Guardian Greaves as well, and Moo is going to be able to walk away. Glimmer Cape also helping him out.
Yeah,
that's a pretty ambitious gank.
And they could pay their price for it. Ice continues to hang around. Eats a piece of ice right there with the Splinter Shot coming out. And we'll hit him in the... He'll back up and away from it, but you know, that's where you talk about the differences between him and if that was an Earth Spirit, he could have pulled off a two-man grip, get the silence, and kicked him back, possibly. It's you're looking at a Tusk who kind of engages a bit, but as mentioned, just kind of falls flat shortly after that, so I don't know, maybe he could scrap together the money for a Blink, so he could be a Blink Snowball save, kind of a deal, both him and Dazzle, just kind of the paramedics, I suppose, but
maybe
obviously the ideal place.
He's still pretty broke, but here we go. First Aghanim Scepter picked up by the Alchemists. Still flying over via the Courier. I have to imagine this one's going straight to the Venomancer.
Definitely the Tusk there, for sure. Gotta get the kick. The kick is the game winner.
Let's see. Where's it going? And it's right to the Veno. So we've got a level 16.
Oh, Beastmaster got it.
Yep.
Oh, you said Veno. Oh, they both
Veno.
Got it. Oh,
he's done
already
two.
Okay. He has another Aghanim's. That was
we totally
one.
Missed the one on Beastmaster.
That's the Alchemist Factor right there. You can't sleep on the guy. He already gets two of them out. Oh my god.
Okay, yeah, I totally missed that. But when did he farm an entire Aghanim's?
That's what I'm telling you. DC probably also are like, wait, what? He suddenly has two. That's why this hero gets banned in second phase pretty damn often.
You know, I felt like on that last initiation onto the Darkseer, I'm like, man, how did he get that roar off? I felt like that thing was from far away, and of course, it's because the cast range goes up by a pretty significant margin once you get the Aghanim. Takes it down to a 45-second cooldown and 950 cast range. It's actually kind of ridiculous.
Just kind of gives you an idea as far as what Alchemist really brings to your team, and next, I'd imagine, could even be the big weave here for Dazzle soon, and then the armor mitigation just becomes ridiculous, and even a mighty resolution Lifestealer will be caught feeling pretty damn weak here. But I still can't help but feel like maybe this wasn't... I'm sure Wings weren't anticipating with their draft to be in a situation where it's like, okay, we just had to wait for everyone to have an Axe and for our Alk to be totally farmed before we can achieve our win condition, you know? Obviously, DC have been able to kind of stall things out a bit, but this is supposed to be DC's time now, I would imagine, moving forward. I don't know how much longer you want to be holding this game out, and I don't know.
It definitely feels like a stalemate. It's a very minor lead for DC. It's been kind of plateaued at that 5k mark for a while. The big disparity is in experience. They're ahead by about 20k XP right now. The Alk is top of the charts for Wings, but it's those supports that are super underleveled. Dazzle and Tusk, 11 and 12. You look over at DC, Winter Wyvern, already 16, and Lion, 15, just one level away from that final upgrade at Finger of Death. So that's really where the big difference is. DC are doing a much better job splitting the map and sharing the farm for everyone, whereas Wings are putting a lot of their emphasis on this Alchemist basket, and you will feel that difference in the supports. Even the Beastmaster not having that level 3 ult, that does make a difference.
And just the fact of the matter that when you really look at the grand scheme of things, DC are actually just really farming nicely here, and they have multiple cores to really make the most out of being at critical mass here. Weezenboker is starting to look very frightening right now. He's already got the Ags. He's got Chivas. BKB with 8 seconds still, and he's about to have his Octarine now complete. It's him and Lifestealer in this game, too, who's also decked out. Daedalus recently picked up now. Now, the both of them, I could certainly see being able to kind of hold their own against this Alk. And once you make it past the Alk, what else really is there to be afraid of? Because by that point, everyone else has already committed all they had to do.
Not Nova, much. I mean, this next fight will be very telling, because this is Alk's 10-second BKB that he's bought for himself now. So this is the fight where he really needs to make something happen. Tier 3 tower up top has already taken some damage. Wings did use a glyph, and they will rotate most of their heroes back. Everybody except for the Tusk has made it back to the base, but that's enough for DC. They're happy to just do some chip damage, and they will retreat. Maybe thinking about waiting out the next Roche. 2 minutes now. Pretty lengthy respawn, a little bit past the mean there for the average timer. Aegis Cheese, probably worth waiting for. But hey, there's a Blink Dagger out on the Tusk all of a sudden. Ice, finding some additional farms, so yeah, he will have a way to kind of disengage now when he goes snowballing on in.
Looks like they might have found the Tusk. Uh-oh. This should be an easy takedown. And, well, I'm glad you bought that Blink, but that means you can't buy back now. So he's going to be out for nearly a minute without a buyback. This will probably turn into DC just swooping on in for a tier 2. Though it looks like
Alchemist
back at the top or bottom lane. Look at that. Alchemist just rushes down this Dazzle who's stuck and stranded here. And now he's going to be caught in a fight between both Mu and Wee. Wee pops his BKB, but Alco's right for Mu. Mu is going to get saved up from the Cold Embrace of Zoxa. And that's when the kiting begins and it turns into a 3-on-1. And they're going to be taking him down. Resolution already looking for the next target. Gets that kill. It's going to be Faith. And that's a gem on the deck that Mu's going to be picking up. DC cracked the game wide open now. It's not looking like this Alchemist is so mighty anymore. DC have really hit their stride, and they're going to be going for the closeout. And it's funny because before this broke out, my point was going to be like, this is always where the old DC felt like, I felt like they had a hard time closing games out. They're huge, they're in charge, but they couldn't finish the game, and they might be able to do it here.
Wow.
We'll see.
That was a bold play. Weehaw with the surprise inside just walks into the tier 3 with a tier 2 still standing, says, hey Venno, what's up? Venno pops the BKB, they force the buyback on Alchemist, and then they just run away. Like, that was the easiest buyback forcing I think I've ever seen. That was a very strange rotation, but it worked like a charm. I mean, even just getting a BKB charge off on the Venno, that was his 8-second BKB. That's a big victory there. And by the way, Venno has a butterfly now.
He certainly does there, Zahori. He certainly does. That is a butterfly on the Venomancer. So, you know, as mentioned, Alchemist is the big damage, and what's there behind him? I guess they want a Venomancer who can provide a little bit of a swift right-click, and he's going to be that much more durable. I don't forecast an MKB here on any of these heroes anytime soon. Maybe we could just go into a Bloodthorn at some point. Nice quick BKB reaction for him. We'll avoid the stun coming in from the Alk, but... you know, they're not going to have too much of a way to break through the evasion on that front, I guess, but I don't know.
I mean, that's something. He does like mobility items, and now that you have Flutter, you know, you've got this little sprint for Venno. It is a good combination of giving you survivability and damage. I mean, he is an agility hero, so he does get some nice damage out of that, even though you kind of think of him as a caster. Very, very unique. I think that's the perfect word for it.
I couldn't have said it any better. Yeah.
Not too many teams going for the butterfly Venno. This is where if we had a stats guy, I would definitely like to see, get the spread on that, this patch. How many Vennos have actually completed a butterfly in an official. But anyhow, Roche 3 goes down again uncontested in favor of DC. Aegis going to the Invoker this time. And the Cheese currently in the hands of the Darkseer. Mu here, he's got his Blink Dagger, his Shivas, this Darkseer. Pretty darn happy at this stage. She's gonna go cruising on in, almost finds the Alchemist, but he does TP out in time. Faith, everyone gonna make it back on the side of Wings.
So really, at this point moving forward for DC, you know, now you got an Aegis on your hand, you finish rounding out whatever item you're looking to get now, and you make your go for Wings. Buyback has been already used on this Alchemist, so you take him down one more time. The game is pretty much yours. Your Butterfly Venomancer, it's cute and all, but I don't think it's going to be too much trouble for Resolution or Wii to take care of.
There's a Hex now on Soxa, so they've got two Blink Hex Initiators between the Lion and the Winter Wyvern. That is damn scary. I mean, that's potentially game-winning right there. If they can just Link Hex the Alchemist and follow up with another stun, crowd control him before he can use the BKB, that's your golden ticket to winning this game. His buyback is on cooldown for another 4 minutes. This is a pretty big window for DC where they just have to kill the Alchemist once. They still have Aegis and Cheese. They kill him without buyback. They should be able to pretty much just run up to the high ground. They'll find Faith Dion deep in enemy territory. The place to be. He doesn't have a buyback either.
Yeah, I'm not sure what the play was there. If he was trying to set up some sort of operation along with the Boots of Travel Hawk or something being that deep, or just getting some intel to see the rotations in DC. But now he is going to be out for nearly a minute, no buyback, so it's not a surprise to see DC already coming and knocking at the Wings door here. Without having to worry about a roar, yeah, thank you very much, we'll take that fight. DC goes in, and now it's pressure on Wings to prevent this, because this could be game-ending if they can't stop it, because no buyback, again, on this Alchemist.
Yep, so Beastmaster can buy back now. They do have a glyph. Ways that Wings can kind of reset this. DC gonna go straight for the weak tower, the tier 3 in the top lane. Resolution goes in, just right clicks it down with the rage on. EMP tornado does connect on the Venomancer, but they'll also use the glyph here. Wings holding on pretty effectively. They've only lost a tier 3. DC get a free sigil kill as they wait for this Beastmaster to respawn. Looks like now the glyphs comes out, DC not gonna back up. Weeha just goes cruising on in. He is the one with the Aegis of the Immortal, so he can be afford to be a little more aggressive with his positioning. They will just back out.
Yeah, I don't know though how far they want to back out. They're definitely in the winning position here, so maybe just a bit of a reset, get this lane pressured in on forward, continue to have Weeha just low ground siege with this 2 minutes left on an Aegis. And back to the top lane to go with Araxes already exposed. This could be it right now for Wings. Let's see if they can hold up.
Yeah, they go straight onto the barracks. Great idea from DC to go objective base. Primal Roar comes out onto Resolution, but there's no follow-up. They isolate the Alchemist, and DC get the high prize that they came for. That's a melee barracks down.
It is nice, you know, having this Ags on the Beastmaster. He can almost have a roar for every push. It's 45 seconds. It's, you know, roughly around the time that, you know, any given push coming in from DC will be at that moment. So, let's see, though. Unless DC really ramp it up right now and catch him while it's, like, the 5 second difference or whatnot. But not letting up DC continue to just sweat out Wings here while they have to work with cooldowns.
This is so hard to deal with. The Alacrity plus Moonshard on Lifestealer. He attacks so fast. How do you deal with this? They're just basically oscillating rage cooldowns at this point. He has six seconds to lay into the barracks, and that's more than enough time to get the right clicks in. Faith Dion on the low ground goes in onto Misery. Shadow forces that forward. BKB, Poison Nova on the whole team. BKB's popped aplenty. DC lose their Lion off the bat. They are going to start to back up and reset. Surprise inside of Weeha, still holding on to the Aegis of the Immortal. Deafening Blast sets up for a back wall. Shadow getting low, but out comes the Shallow Grave. It's still looking like an okay hold for Wings, but now DC starting to overpower them. EMP Tornado again gets the kill on Venno. Now the kill on Alk. Venno buys back straight away, but Alchemist still down for the count. No buyback for about 60 seconds here. They lose the Tusk, and now DC taking over. They dive past the base, and Wings, they don't even want to play it out. They call GG. The godlike streak for Resolution continues. 15-0-8 in 47 minutes. He ends this game undefeated. And when it's all said and done, a pretty convincing win for Digital Chaos in their opening match here in the Manila Major, 30-11 in total kills.